Water waves come in all shapes and sizes, from tiny ripples to huge swells and everything in between. And when the conditions are just right, they can break on the coast in amazing ways, allowing humans and animals to surf them. How exactly does this happen? How can the ocean go from this to this in a relatively short amount of time? In this video, we're going to dive into the science behind water waves. And spoiler alert, we'll learn how scientists still don't know exactly how they happen. If you're enjoying these videos and want to support us to make more, the best way to help us is to purchase some gear at waterlust.com. We make environmentally responsible swimwear that is specifically designed for a day in the waves. Whether our UV-protective swim leggings, our bomb-proof board shorts, or silk-weight sun shirts, we've got you covered head to toe for your next adventure. As a small family-run business, your support means the world to us. Water waves come in a lot of different flavors, ranging from tiny capillary waves, to chop, to open ocean swells. All of these waves are classified as surface gravity waves, and are created by wind blowing over the surface of water. It may surprise you, but exactly how ocean waves form from flat water and grow from tiny little wavelets into large swells is the subject of ongoing research. But here is a summary of where things stand today. In physical oceanography, today's understanding of wave formation and growth comes directly from what is known as the Miles-Phillips mechanism. The combination of two slightly different theories from the Californian scientist John Miles and the Australian scientist Owen Phillips, who, oddly enough, both published their work independently in 1957. The Phillips theory does best in describing the early stage of wave growth, where the Miles theory does better in predicting the growth of more developed seas. That's why a combination of the two are used today. Phillips' theory focuses on atmospheric pressure variations and their role in creating and growing waves. Here's how it works. When wind travels over water, the air at the water's surface tends to move very slowly, but gets faster the higher up you go, something kite surfers are very familiar with. This creates a shear profile in the wind, a region where the speed of the wind is changing rapidly with height. You can think of shear like trying to hold hands with two people walking at different speeds. If one person is walking fast and the other is walking slow, it causes the whole group to twist, and in fluid mechanics, this twisting is called vorticity. Vorticity is a fancy word for the chaotic twists and turns that happen in turbulent flow. We don't really notice any of this because air is invisible, but these turbulent flows are full of vortices that create small variations in atmospheric pressure that push the water's surface, and when the conditions are right, a baby wave is born. Also known as a wavelet, which is adorable, these tiny waves move at a speed that is controlled by their size, Earth's gravity, and the material characteristics of water. A key point to Phillips' theory is how the peaks and troughs of these baby waves can become aligned with the atmospheric pressure fluctuations, creating a resonance mechanism that allows them to grow and grow. The Phillips theory aligns well with observations in nature for the early formation of waves from a flat sea, but it tends to underpredict how quickly waves can grow once they're formed. To better predict that, we need Miles. Miles' theory says that the speed of a wave and the speed of wind can be equal at certain heights within the wind shear layer we talked about earlier. And when this happens, it is thought that momentum is transferred from the air into the water, which grows the wave. This theory ignores turbulence and doesn't explain how baby waves are initially formed from a flat sea, but it does a good job of predicting the growth of waves once they exist. Understanding all the details of the Miles-Phillips mechanism requires a pretty advanced knowledge base in physics, but even a beginner can appreciate the big picture, that wind transfers its energy into the water by creating waves, and the longer and stronger the wind blows, the bigger the waves it creates. If you've ever been in a storm, you'll notice that wind doesn't create just one kind of wave. Small, medium, and large waves will occur simultaneously and move in many directions. The speed that waves move in deep water is controlled by their wavelength, with longer waves moving faster than shorter waves. This property of water waves is called dispersion, and the surface of water is called a dispersive medium. This detail is very important to how waves affect large bodies of water. When a storm occurs and waves are created, longer wavelength waves move away from the storm faster than shorter wavelength waves. And because they have so much momentum and water has such little internal friction, they're able to travel huge distances around the world. These waves are so important that they get their own name. We call them swells or groundswells, and they're defined as waves that were created in far-off storms but travel into new regions where the weather conditions may be different. This is an important point for the sport of surfing. If waves only occurred when the wind blows, you could only surf in blown-out stormy conditions, which wouldn't be all that fun. But because of dispersion and the ability of swells to outrun all the lower wavelength waves created in a storm, we can have clean, organized waves during a sunny, windless day, which is much more enjoyable for a surfer. But if you've ever paddled out for a surf or sat at the beach and watched swells crash into the shore, you've probably noticed that they look different than waves in the open ocean. They're bigger, steeper, and can break in dramatic ways. How and why does that happen? To understand that, we need to look at how waves move. Many people don't realize, but waves don't cause water to move all that much. While it may look like water is physically moving quickly with a wave, what you're really seeing is energy moving through water, which when you stop and think about it, is pretty wild. If you track individual water parcels as a wave passes in deep water, you'll see that water moves in circles, and the farther down from the surface you go, the smaller the circular motion becomes. This dissipation in wave motion with depth means that water won't circle back to exactly the same position that it started, since its forward velocity at the shallower depth is slightly greater than its return velocity at the deeper depth. This net movement of water caused by waves was first discovered by George Gabriel Stokes in 1847 and is called Stokes Drift after him. Interesting note, the word stoked would emerge as surfer slang for excited or exhilarated in surfing culture in the 1960s. And while there's no formal attribution to Stokes, the wave mathematician and physicist, one has to wonder if there is a connection. Stokes drift isn't very fast. The net movement of water only ends up around a few centimeters per second. But even still, it transports things all over the ocean, like marine debris, including huge logs you sometimes find on beaches. The orbital motions that waves create are important to understanding how waves change as they approach land. When a wave enters shallow water, the presence of the seafloor gradually reduces the water's ability to move up and down. If you've ever been at a crowded concert and tried to work your way close to the stage, you've experienced a similar effect. Far away, people can more easily make headway towards the stage, but the closer you get, the harder it becomes. And if you're lucky enough to get all the way to the stage, you reach a hard limit. You can't go any closer. Metaphorically, the seafloor acts in a similar way. The closer water gets to it, the slower it's able to move towards it. Because of this, as water gets shallower, the circular motion we described earlier becomes depressed into flatter and flatter ellipses. And as more and more water is prevented from undulating down, the more water accumulates up top, resulting in a wave that grows in height. But hold on, how can a wave get bigger just by entering shallow water? Doesn't that like violate conservation of energy? That's a great question and leads to the final concept you need to understand about water waves. The total energy of a water wave is the sum of the kinetic energy of water moving in its orbits and the gravitational potential energy of water moving up and down. As a wave enters shallow water and the seafloor forces its height to grow, the total gravitational potential energy increases. And because energy is conserved, its kinetic energy must simultaneously decrease, meaning the wave slows down. And because of dispersion, that thing we mentioned earlier where longer waves move faster than shorter waves, the wavelength must also simultaneously decrease. This process of waves growing in height, slowing down, and getting closer together as they enter shallow water is called shoaling, and it has major consequences. As swells approach a coastline at an angle, the section of the wave that enters shallow water first slows down, while the part of the wave in deeper water goes faster. This is called wave refraction, and it causes waves to bend towards shallow water, and it's why most days you go to the beach, you'll see waves coming straight towards the land. And sadly, it's here where the life of a wave ends. As water gets shallower and a wave grows its height, it reaches a critical point where it can't hold itself up anymore and breaks. When a wave breaks, it not only can create amazing shapes for lucky surfers, but it transfers all its energy into the water, causing strong currents, stirring up sediments, and shaping coastlines. The life of waves is an amazing story, and the science behind how they work is complex, ongoing, and fascinating. From the birth of a baby wavelet through the Miles-Phillips mechanism, to longer waves moving faster than shorter waves because of dispersion, to the circular orbits and Stokes drift waves create, to the shoaling effects that bend waves towards the coast and grow them into beautiful surf. All these complex concepts add up to describing something we see every day, and is a reminder how the scientific process helps us understand how the world works, one wave at a time.